Hi everyone, it's Emmanuel here. Last night I was watching the movie Prince of Egypt with my wife, and I think it was produced 10 years ago, like a Disney-type movie, which outlines kind of, the story in Exodus, where Moses was commanded by God to take the people of Israel out of Egypt, and it depicts the whole scene, right? The 10 plagues and everything, and how Pharaoh wouldn't let the people go, and so God released all these type of plagues on there, and at the end of the movie, Moses was able to bring the people of Israel out of Egypt, part the Red Sea, went across, and that's how it ends. And we know that's not how the story ends. Obviously, the biblical account keeps on going, but they can't keep on, it's only a 1.5 hour movie, so they stopped it at the Red Sea. But when I was thinking about this, okay, because the animation was really done really well, and when Moses was taking up a staff and then the Red Sea parted, right? Like hundreds of thousands of people were walking across it. All the water was like spiking up like this, two huge like waterside, and there's this little middle valley people just walked over. And I was thinking about that, I'm like, wow, that's really, like, if I was at that scene right there at that moment in time, like, I mean, what would you think if you were there at that moment? You would have been like, this is something that you will never forget in your entire life. This is God telling Moses that, he's gonna take us out of Egypt, out of slavery, because he's heard our cry, right? And so they went over. And not just that, even in the biblical account, we were told, and in the movie this is portrayed as well, after they crossed to the other side, when the Egyptians wanted to pursue them on the same path, what do we know? We know that they were wiped away because God made the water came back to level. So think about this. If you were at that moment in time, that is probably going to be one of the most remarkable things you'll ever remember in life. I mean, who will ever see like ocean part, like the sea part, and you walk right in the middle of it, seeing all the fish and all the stuff, whales on the side and everything, right? But you know what the interesting thing is? This is what got me thinking, right? Because when we read Exodus chapter 14, okay, this is right after Moses had led them out of the Red Sea, okay, and continue to go on a journey to the promised land that God promised them. It says in Exodus chapter 14, verse 31, actually starting in verse 30, so the Lord saved Israel that day out of the hand of the Egyptians, and Israel saw the Egyptians dead on the seashore. Okay, so Israel passed by, Israelites passed by, saw that the Egyptians were wiped away as they want to come through. They saw that. Thus, verse 31, Israel saw the great work which the Lord had done in Egypt, so the people feared the Lord and believed the Lord and his servant Moses. And then later on, they praised God, right? Then Moses and the children of Israel started to praise God. I will sing to the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. They keep on going there. But what's kind of interesting when we really think about this? Because if you read the biblical account, you know how the story kind of progressed, right? They didn't really stay at that stage of fearing the Lord, believing God, praising him throughout the way. They didn't do that, because what did they do? We know that the children of Israel, as they started to, actually, just when they started wandering into the wilderness, we just find it right in the next chapter. They're like, man, like, I've been traveling for a while, have no water. They find this water, and it's bitter. They can't drink it. So they go and complain to Moses. And Moses, man, you brought us out here. We got no water to drink. So then God spoke to Moses and it's like, okay, you see that tree there? Take that tree, throw in the water. He did. And the water became sweet and they could drink again. Okay? So just right after they came out of Red Sea, they start complaining already. Now there's a point to this, but we're going to go through a couple more before we relate this back to our own lives and see what's the significance of this. They get the water, okay? Now they don't have food. What are they going to eat, right? God, the people complain to Moses. Moses says, look, this is going to be a sign that God is with us. He's promised us, okay? So not only is God giving them manna, like bread from heaven, at night he's going to give you meat. We find this in Exodus chapter 16. Okay? And then Moses tells them, listen guys, these things will be done, but your complaints are not against us, but against the Lord. Exodus chapter 16, verse 8. Okay? And so, if we skip forward a little bit more into like Joshua chapter 5, verse 6. This is a very interesting thing. It says, for the children of Israel walked 40 years in the wilderness till all the people who were men of war who came out of Egypt were consumed because they did not obey the voice of the Lord. They didn't, right? What happened? Like some people obeyed the Lord, of course, but some didn't. But remember, they all started on the same level playing ground. All the children of Israel were led out of Egypt, out of slavery, because God heard their cry. And they're praising God. It says that in Exodus chapter 15, when they just got brought out, right? They all feared the Lord. They all believed God. They all saw the miraculous work, how God has brought them out of Egypt, how the Red Sea was parted, how the Egyptians were wiped out. But why was it, okay, that at the end, that God had to let the people of Israel wandering for 40 years in the wilderness and not going into the promised land? Geologically speaking, it doesn't even need to take that long. Okay? Why did that happen? Well, God says because they didn't obey the Lord. What happened? Moses went to, well, one of the examples, you look at it, Moses was going up, okay, to get the Ten Commandments from God, getting instruction from God, and he went up to the mountain, right? And then the people thought, well, like after a time, like because the Bible says because he delayed his coming, Moses, and so the people are like, I don't know where he went. Hey, Aaron, come here. Right? Aaron, the spokesperson for Moses, like, hey, come here. You know, make us a god that we can, you know, lead us and guide us so that we can worship. So they created a golden calf. You know? Why did they do that? Didn't they remember what God had done for them? Did they remember that, you know, the Egyptians were wiped away? Didn't they remember that God rained down bread in the morning and meat at night for them to eat? Didn't they remember that God turned, you know, the bitter water into sweet water that they can drink? These are questions that, you know, you kind of think about. But when you think about this, it's not just for the people of Israel. We got to think about this in our own lives, right? Maybe we have not seen something so dramatic like the Red Sea part. I'm sure some people have seen very dramatic things. And there's some things in your life that you know there's absolutely no way that unless there's divine intervention that something could happen or something could not have happened. So many times when God protected you from being killed, like in a car accident or something like that, there are many times, like close calls, overseas mission trips where I could have been like jailed with my wife, things like that. Like when you look at or like driving on like a super winter day, your car could have spun and fallen in either ditches but didn't. Normally it would. So many things in your life when you look at it, you know that God's hand was there. Now the question that we could ask ourselves is this, okay? Are we going to do what the Bible says to keep our faith steadfast till the end? Because Jesus says in Matthew chapter 24, verse 12, because lawlessness will abound, the love of many will grow cold, and he who endures till the end shall be saved. Okay? A lot of the many thousands of Israelites, okay, have been killed, punished by God because they didn't obey the voice of the Lord. In fact, the land opened up and in one day swallowed thousands and thousands of people and they died. And not only that, we know that in 40 years, all these people who complained and didn't obey the Lord, they died. And the next generation, people who are in the next generation of Israelites, they went in and saw the promised land. They saw it. But the people who complained, the people who didn't obey the Lord, they couldn't see it. So this is a kind of an alarming thing. First of all, let's establish one thing, and that is God keeps his promise. And God's character is good, and that's why he heard his people's cry and took them out of Egypt. That was his intention. And he says, if you obey my voice, you will heed my voice. Okay, this is a land flowing with milk and honey. This is all for your taking. But you're going to have to kind of walk with me. Okay? Has God spoken the same thing to you and I today? What has God spoken to you? What's something that, you know, that's been on your heart? You know, God says, I'm going to take you on this journey. And you're going to glorify me on this path. And I want you, you may not be going preaching to millions of people like Billy Graham or whatever, but God has given each one of us, I believe, a specific assignment that we are to fulfill in this life before we go and to see Jesus into eternity. For those who repent and trust in Jesus, this is our eternal destiny. But my prayer is that we will not be like the children of Israel who disobeyed God, who complained. Okay, in the midst of so many evidence that God has given in our lives, you know, the evidence of parting the Red Sea, of turning the water from bitter to sweet, of giving us manna, bread from heaven, meat from heaven. Okay? I mean, all these things. I mean, God has given each one of us solid signs, solid. If you're a Christian, you know that God has worked in some part of your life. And so what we need to do today, and when we reflect on this, is say, God, is there any area in my life right now that I am not grateful, that I'm just complaining? When you're giving me manna from heaven, you're giving me meat from heaven, I'm not satisfied. I want something more. I want, I don't know, like fruits, ice cream. I'm not saying God can't give you ice cream. I mean, I like ice cream. You know what I mean? What I'm saying is, are we having a heart of gratitude and of praise and of worship, just like the people of Israel from the very beginning? Right? You know, it's easy to believe God when good things happen, when God answers our prayers, and we see it, right? Just when the people got taken out from Egypt, when they're brought out of the Red Sea, what did it say? It said that all the people believed God. They feared God. And they all saw the work and the wonders of God. Right? Everybody's going to start on that level playing field. But you know what? The Christian journey is not always smooth sailing. You know, Jesus never promised a life that everything is going to be fine. You're going to have all this. I mean, yeah, God can bless you. God can, you know, you walk with God. You look at this promise. You receive it by faith. Yeah, but Jesus also promised that in this life, as a Christian, we will receive persecution. There will be trials and tribulation. What do you do at those moments? Are you going to complain? Are you going to grumble? Are you going to disobey God just because, you know, you're at the situation where, you know, it's not so peachy, it's not so great? Are you going to build a golden calf when things seem to be delayed? Like Moses went and getting the Ten Commandments. And then you're like, man, I guess God's laying his answer. You go find your own answer. You go create your own golden calf. Obviously, you may not really build a golden calf, but you may, you know, consult something else. I don't know. Some people consult psychics, you know, that calls upon demonic spirits to know, you know, certain things. Maybe not to that extreme. Maybe you go look into something else on your own. So each person is different. But the thing that we need to do is to come before God and say, God, I pray, Holy Spirit, that you reveal to me. I just want to walk my life, okay, obediently following you. It's not easy, okay? This is very easily said often, but it's not easily walked out. So something that we need to constantly, daily come before the grace of God, before the throne of grace to receive his mercy. Because you know what? There is a promised land. There is a promised land for every single true born-again believer in Jesus Christ. And that promised land is the hope of glory, eternity, in heaven, the new Jerusalem, when Jesus comes back. That is our promised land. But you know what? Jesus said, okay, in the Gospels, Mark chapter 4, Matthew chapter 13, he gave the parable, saying that there are different seeds sown on different soils. Not all seeds sown on all types of soils are going to bring through 30, 60, 100 fold. Some of them, in fact, he says, in that parable, only about 25% actually start to bear fruit. So when you think about it, the children of Israel all saw the works of God, all believed God, all feared God in the beginning. But not all stayed that course. And may you and I reflect on that and pray that we will stay the course, that we will be the good. If you want to read that parable, I'm not going to go into it today. I have another video talking about it. Okay, you can search my YouTube channel. But in Matthew chapter 13, Jesus talks about different types of soils. There's some soils that are sown on stony grounds. Okay. Some seed sown on rocky, like rocks. That's this type of soil. So the seed sown on the rocks, there's no root in it, no foundation. Okay, so it sprouted out with just like a moment of joy, of rejoicing, and later on it fell away because there's no root. When something bad happens, oh, I don't believe in God. Because, you know, people think, oh, God has to bless me of all these things. And if he doesn't bless me, if he doesn't do the same thing exactly how I asked for it. I've received emails like that. People are saying like, oh, this guy tells me, you know, I'm not going to believe in God anymore. Or, you know, I have quote unquote believe in him. But because he didn't meet this promise that he said and my timing right now, the way I want it, exactly how I want it as it is, then, you know, it's not going to work for me then. Is that how you look at it? Is God like a fending machine to you? Okay? Now don't get me wrong. What I mean, like, for promises that God has given us, we don't have to wait. We don't have to wait for salvation. Today is the day of salvation. That's not what I'm talking about. Healing has already been done. Jesus has been striped so you can be healed. Right now, you're not waiting on God. God's waiting on you to believe in his promise, to receive it by faith. So when I'm not talking about God, you know, sovereignty being all fickle everywhere, you know, like you don't know when. I'm talking about certain things in your life. Okay, some things that are not really clearly outlined in the Bible. Career path, the choice of your spouse, things like that. Difficulty, death of the family member, relatives, hardships in life, friends, situations that happens that you don't understand. That's something that I'm wrestling with. Sometimes I really look at it. Different things, very horrible things happen in life to children, adults. Why do they happen? I don't know. I'm still praying this through. But you know what I can count on? I can count on the character of God revealed in the Bible. I can count on his promises. I can count on the cross of Calvary. That's what I can count on. That there is a hope, that there is a promise. So may you and I come before God today, right now, and pray and say, God, is there any area in my life that I'm acting like the unthankful, grumbling, complaining Israelites? Rather, God, if I'm doing that, please help me repent. And please help me remember that you are the one and only true God. Help me, directed me, taught me, embraced me, comforted me. May you bring me back to those times so that I can stay the course in the midst of hardship, tribulation, persecution, trouble, whatever it is. Because I know that when I walk with you, because when I trust in you, I will enter into the promised land by faith. So may this be you and my prayer, where when repentance need be, that we repent before God, where faith needs to be renewed, our focus needs to be renewed. Let it be done right now. May it be, we do what Paul tells us in his letters. In all things, give thanks, because this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you and I. And let me tell you something about gratitude and a heart of thankfulness. It changes everything. Situation may not change, but when you change your attitude, the way you look at things, gratitude, thankfulness, instead of looking at what you don't have, looking at what you do have, that changes everything. Instead of looking how seemingly God is not answering your prayers, look at how God has answered so many of your past prayers. And when you look at that, that renews your faith, and faith activates prayer answered. Because you're no longer, you know, back and forth, like in James, tossed to and fro. You're not gonna get anything like that. But looking unto Jesus, the finisher of our faith. Okay, that's how we continue to walk this walk with God. So let us pray right now. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, we give you praise and we thank you that you are the one and only true God who never changes. And we thank you, you never change, and you never leave us or forsake us, just as you never left those who were with the Israelites back in the time. But we know that there was a generation who were not grateful, who complained, who disobeyed you, and that's why they didn't see the promised land. That's why they wandered in the wilderness and died. But God, I pray that this day that we will not be like that generation of Israelites, that we will be those who are of the next generation, who believe in you, who hold fast in our faith in you, God. That we will see the promised land, that will believe in you, that will fear you, that will praise you and worship you from the beginning till the end. And in the times when we fail, in the times when we fall, pick us up, God, that renew our faith, that we continue to follow steadfast after you, God, because we know that you are gracious, you know that you are faithful, God. So bring us home to the promised land. And while we're here on this earth, use us mightily for your glory and for your kingdom. And every mission, every assignment you've given for each one of our lives, for those who are watching this video in my life, God, help us fulfill it. Help us do it. And lead us. Open doors for us and close doors that we shouldn't be going to, God. And may we give you glory, and may we give you praise and honor that you so deserve. Bless our families, God. And protect our families that we can walk on this path to serve you and honor you. And we declare you King. And we declare you Lord until you come back. Help us remain faithful, steadfast in their faith until the end. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
When I survey the wondrous cross on which the sorrow meet. Oh. love demands my soul. My